Right, and again, I'm back for part two because things went stupidly over time and I had to split this up. So, without further ado, back to the questions. Andrew Wyatt, why did the US go so long without a long-range anti-tank system like Spike NLOS? The Israelis have had this since the mid-80s, and given we have no qualms with buying from them, why did we go? We do have qualms buying from the Israelis. I remember going to the maneuver conference back maybe 2011, 2012, and I think it was Raytheon had a stand for their active protection system. And Raphael were there, or was it Raphael do Trophy? And they had their stand with Trophy as well. And I'm going, look, the Trophy system's already being implemented. Congratulations, Raytheon, for doing, but why are we doing this? And look what the Army is currently putting onto its vehicles, Trophy. Now, I was having a chat with another officer, retired now, and he points out some perfectly correct limitations to Trophy and why perhaps Trophy is just a stopgap and not the ideal either. But still, this is 10 years after, you know, 10 years after I saw it first. So that said, there are, I mean, if it really is that good and we don't have anything remotely like it, we will buy anything from the Popeye missiles to, you know, what have you. As for the NLOS, the closest I think would be the Fog M, the fiber optic guided missile. And that was supposed to be a missile that had non-line of sight capability. The MRM, the mid-range munition, was supposed to be a tank cannon fired guided projectile, which could also theoretically be non-line of sight. But it wasn't a missile. It was actually a kinetic energy or kinetic velocity, whatever. It's called, the impulse from the gun was what sent the thing firing. Not, there wasn't a motor behind it, as I recall. So I think, like a lot of the weapon systems that the US has played with in the last 10 or 15 years, is a case of, yeah, good to know, but we got this insurgency going on right now that we need the dollars for, so we're going to cancel everything else. So together with FCS and GCV and whatever the hell else the Army's been canceling, Fog M went the same direction. Hammer of Terror. The Unitron tank seems quite capable for the 21st century. High mobility and top speed, good ground clearance, well armored and with an advanced remote control. When there is no Mysteron, Captain Scarlet. When there's no Mysteron, that explains why I haven't heard of this thing. It is, however, armed with a coaxial flamethrower. Assuming such weapons are still permitted on the battlefield in the first place, is there any non-psychological role that a modern alternative cannot perform at least as well with fewer or no humanitarian? What is this humanitarian in the humanitarian issues? I don't think I need to go look up the Unitron tank to answer this. I'm going to, when I'm done with this video, I'm going to go look up the Unitron tank and figure out what the hell it is. I haven't thought about Captain Scarlet in 3 years. Oh, dear God. If you don't know what it is, it was one of the Gerry Anderson Marionation, I think they called it, videos. And Captain Scarlet, it was very, sort of the puppets were a lot more realistic. Scarlet was an invulnerable member of Spectrum, was the organization. And the bad guy was Captain Black. I'm sure it's on YouTube. Anyway, he goes, just go back a few years. Coaxial flamethrowers. So there were obviously some such weapons. Usually a flamethrower would be either bow mounted in the hull, such as on the Crocodile, the Churchill Crocodile, or it would, or the M5 Satan, or it would be the main gun, such as whatever the M48 version. It's the M67, I think, might have been the flamethrower version of the M48 Patton. Which was the main gun, was replaced by an entire flamethrower system. But there were some coaxial flamethrowers. There was at least two Sherman variants. One had some bizarre alphanumeric like PWSCAE, I can't recall, and the other was the T 33, I think, which had the 75, a coaxial machine gun, and a coaxial flamethrower, which, as I recall, was capable of independent elevation. So it can be done. I'm sure there were probably some limitations or liabilities with doing the coaxial with the with the whole lot. Maybe it's more vulnerable, maybe the crews weren't happy, I don't know. But flamethrowers as a whole, there's a reason that you don't see them very much, is that, yes, at least flamethrowers are best used against things that you can't get high explosive into ordinarily. And the flames have this ability of kind of getting through any small gaps, embrasures in pillboxes, things like that. You can't really stop the jet of fuel from getting in and setting something alight. So these days, if you meet a bunker, instead of using a flamethrower, you just crack it with a saber round or an obstacle reducing round or something, and then you put a couple of rounds of HE into it. Or you can use a thermobaric round, perhaps. So, yeah, the last time I've ever heard of a fire weapon, an incendiary weapon in the traditional sense, even being fielded, would have been the Falklands. I'm not sure they were dropped. And that wasn't the flamethrower, it was just plain air-delivered napalm. Right, Jamie McMillan. Another opinion piece. Oh, thanks. What are my general thoughts on the Halo Scorpion? Halo Scorpion tank is an actual tank. What is it with the sci-fi tanks today? As an actual tank, and which real Cold War weapon or modern counterpart would I most compare it to in terms of tech specs and role? Ignoring, of course, the fact that it has 6 pedals and twice as many tracks for funless hours of endless tensioning. Okay, so the Scorpion, Sheila. If you don't know the Scorpion, I don't play Halo. All I know, the only reason I know the Scorpion tank is from Red vs. Blue. It's got 4 independent tracks, which I don't believe steer. So I'm not sure why they have 4 independent tracks. And there were such designs. The Astron tank, the AE. I think the Hen and Chick might have been as well. The theoretical advantages to having the 4 tracks, like 4 wheels, is, I guess, if one gets blown, you can keep driving on the other 3. That's the only advantage I can think of, because you are losing the effect of ground pressure, because there is that space in between the front and the rear track that is, the weight isn't being spread. And you have 2 additional drivetrains to worry about. Plus what it does to controlled steering is another matter entirely yet. So maybe if the Scorpion uses an electrical drivetrain instead of a mechanical one, it might work. But if you think about how a modern cross-drive steering system works on a tank, and then you try to apply that to 4 different sprocket wheels around the vehicle, that starts becoming a very significant engineering challenge, I would argue. Now, the other thing about it, the original Scorpion had an exposed crewman's hatch, which, if you, I think, has a problem. But later versions, I do note that they put the driver behind cover. The gun system is way up high, so it's not just, it is an extended weapons platform. It increases the silhouette of the tank ridiculously. I presume it gives it a great depression. I don't know. Again, I don't play Halo, so I don't know how low that gun will depress. But the closest system to that was going to be the RDF that I'd mentioned in a, I think it was 3 Q&As ago, 2 or 3 Q&As ago. Have I really been doing this more than a year now? Helmet mounted, apparently, sight. So as the crewman inside turns around, it also aims the gun a bit like an Apache. In terms of technical specs, so it was a lot bigger than the RDF tank, though. Would it be like TTB? I don't know. I honestly don't know how heavily armored the Scorpion tank is. I'm not sure I can answer the question. Why does it have 6 pedals? I don't know. There's only 4 directions, as the caboose would say. I'm also going to put in a plug for Tim Gaughan. Tim Gaughan writes, since we're on the topic of since we're on the topic of fantasy science fiction tanks, the repeated topic of fantasy science fiction tanks, Tim Gunn is the author of the Old Guy trilogy. It's an increasingly inadequately named trilogy, or incorrectly named trilogy, as Douglas Adams would put it. The Cyber Tank series, the Old Guy series, and it turns out that he actually watches the Chieftain's Hatch. Hi, Tim. So, in a moment of insomnia, he wrote a short story, which I am placing a link to it in the text below, and you may find it amusing. Let's say it is relevant to this channel. He does mention track tensioning. Warlord Titan Tiberius, why does the myth of Polish military incompetence continue to persist, especially the dragoons charging with swords at German tanks? I think at this point that myth is starting to die. I think most people now realize that it didn't happen, and it is a wild misreading of what actually did happen. And what actually did happen was that the Polish charged a dismounted unit, made lots of noise, a nearby armored reconnaissance unit went to go check it out, and then engaged the cavalry, who then attempted, reasonably enough, to attempt to bugger off. But no, the Poles did not lower lances and try to charge armored vehicles. They weren't that stupid. And also, even if you look at how long it took the Germans swamped over the Poles. Well, the Poles actually held out reasonably well for a while. I don't think it really made much difference that the Soviets came along the backside and came up their rear. They don't like it up them. I think your question is founded on a false premise. I don't think anybody thinks that the Poles were militarily incompetent. Now, you can certainly make the argument that the Air Force didn't do them any great credit, but the Army, I think nowadays that myth is gone. Jonathan Schreiber, most challenging aspect of operating a tank is the limited visibility and ability of the enemy infantry to operate in the blind spots. Has anyone tried to create a see-through headset similar to the F-35? I don't know about the F-35, but yes. A tank that offered true 365-degree visibility. 365? The Israelis have been mucking around with this for a couple of years now. They call it Iron Vision. And it's exactly as it's described. It's a big-ass helmet that projects the field of vision from cameras on the outside of the vehicle. So as you turn right, it kind of merges this camera and this camera to give you the vision at the right. And apparently DARPA is trying to do the same thing here, according to Time Bomb. So yes, they're trying to do it. Now, I would put a note of caution. I don't think it will do anywhere near as much as many people think it will. Yes, it will give extra vision, and yes, even with super improved cameras issuing in 4K, I still think that the human eye is going to have is going to be a little bit better at picking up little pixels and what have you. Maybe also at night, the human eye might be a little bit better than. Unless they turn it into FLIR. Maybe they can hook it up to a FLIR system. Okay, that's possible. But it's not going to eliminate the requirement, I don't think, of having infantrymen roam around as well. But yes, it's being done, I guess, is the short answer to your question. Timebomb 757, thinking back to my video on tanks defending themselves against aircraft, is the process for engaging a helicopter the same as engaging a fixed wing, i.e. do you attempt to throw up a wall of tracers to scare them off, or do you actually attempt to engage them? You try to shoot them. Traditionally, you'll use a saber round. You need a direct hit. But at least with a saber round, it's not all that hard to get a direct hit on a helicopter, relatively speaking. The MPAT round, which actually the only round I had in Iraq, has a proximity fuse. So if you MPAT air is the command, the loader just flips the fuse from the default contact setting to proximity setting, slams it in the breech, and you fire the round. and after an arming distance, if anything gets within 30 yards of it, or whatever it was, it detonates and the fragmentation goes and shoots down the helicopter, in theory. If you're in a vehicle that can fire missiles, you can shoot a missile at a helicopter, especially if it's a fast missile like the Soviet ones. The preferred way of dealing with a helicopter is hope he doesn't see you. However, if they're going to come, if it looks like they're doing a run on you, shoot back. What do you got to lose? You got a better chance you do against an aircraft fixed wing. Fred Benton, what is the most unholy looking Sherman variant I have ever seen? If you're on my Facebook page, I put up some photos of the Centipede, which was an M4. They were doing all sorts of trials of different suspension types just to see if they can get a better one than the VVSS. And they used the suspension off of the T-16 three-quarter track truck. It looks a little bit like the suspension on a half track and an M2 and M3 half track. It's longer. Instead of four wheels to the bogies, there are six pairs of wheels to the bogie. They put two of those under each side of the Sherman, and then they sent that one off on trials. That was pretty damn hideous. The demolition tank, T-31, was pretty damn hideous. And I wasn't a huge fan of the ones that had spikes all over them either. In the Book of Armaments, I had read a comment that more white phosphorus rounds were required as they were useful against tanks. That was the video I did reading reports from North Africa. Would that have been simply blinding them, or was there some nasty way you could get it to affect the crew directly? Well, remember, these tanks are not airtight, so you're going to get some fumes coming in. Now, in reality, they're categorized by the Army as a mild irritant, somewhere after exhaust fumes. But they can be disconcerting, especially if you're not expecting them. And if you're lucky, perhaps they might set air filters or something alight in the engine compartment. Or they might think that, the tank is on fire, which, if you're in the German army, is the only authorized excuse for getting out of the vehicle. So it wasn't unheard of. In a similar vein, what is the smallest single HE round that would be effective against a Tiger or equivalent? In Think Tank, it was mentioned that a Panther was knocked out by multiple 75 HE rounds, concussing the crew to death, while the 152 seemed to be overkill. It was a Tiger, is what Harry Eide mentioned. You battered the thing with HE enough. I don't know if that was ever tested. I don't think I can answer that. Caleb Engelhart, A1 Independent versus T-35, which would win in a no-holds-barred cage match? T-35, if nothing, The turret on the T-35 was basically the same, as I recall, as on the T-28, and the T-28 was a good turret. The vehicle did run, it had no armor, but neither does the A1 Independent, and I don't think the A1 Independent had the addition of the 45mm high-velocity guns. So, yeah. Next question, Oscar Larson. Don't know if he can answer this short or long. How were tanks used in the Vietnam War? That is a long answer. Were there any major tank battles in the Vietnam War? Not that the Americans were involved with, only the Special Forces camp at Ben Het, which was four M48s versus 12 PT-76s, of which three were killed. There were, as I mentioned in the previous video, the Vietnamese had it out, M48s. Were they M48s or M40? What did the South have they were using? I think they were M48s. Anyway, they beat up a bunch of T-55s, like a battalion-level fight. So I think there might have been two of those. But how were they used otherwise? I'm pretty sure I discussed this a little bit in an earlier Q&A, so I'll see if I can dig it up and I'll put the link in the... I'll tell you which one it was in the description. Nakhil Firokezi, who apparently is, which he tells me was something to do with Mr. T doing an advert in German for League of Legends or World of Warcraft or something. Do I know of any reports concerning the acceptance of Soviet tanks in East Germany's National People's Army? how they liked the Soviet equipment, or did they like it? Did they find anything considered as design flaws? Were they allowed to criticize their... That's actually an interesting question. Yeah, this East German. Okay. Were any East German improvements adopted in Warsaw Pact countries? I don't know. And what did West Germany's tank designers think when they were able to have a first-hand look? Okay. So my first thought was when the German army closed in on each other and the West German army absorbed the East German army, what did they do? But no, this is talking about what the East Germans thought about it. I have never seen any documentation. I've never looked for any documentation on this matter. I am hoping next year, if the European Union ever allows Americans back into the area, to get into, go back to Germany and do some videos, either in, I think it's Dresden or Munster. So I shall ask them, and in many, many months I will come back to this question. What did West Germany's tank designers think when they looked at Eastern tanks? Well, bearing in mind, most of them were Eastern vehicles. But the great East German Army closing down sale also allowed a bunch of T-72s to be test-fired upon. And there was a realization that most NATO tank guns couldn't penetrate the T-72 from the front. Only the countries that had gone to the 120, Germany, UK, US... Pretty much everybody else was still using 105s in Centurions and Leopard 1s. And the only 105 that would go through the front of the T-72, the non-export version, was the DU round. So there was a surprise when that happened. How did the former NPA or NVA like their new Western equipment? I don't know. Would they have preferred BMP over Marder, for example? I don't know. Now, I can tell you that Germany was not the only group to get this. So a lot of the vehicles ended up, I believe the Greeks, for example, got a lot of BMPs. So maybe somebody in Greece can answer the question on that. The Swedes got a few. I think they decided they didn't like the BMPs, but they kept the MTLBs around for a while. I think this one is a case of put the answers in the comments below, and I think we can all just check into it and see. Timo Fiebach, what can you tell us about Chinese tank use in World War II? Did they ever fight Japanese tanks, and how effective were they generally? Not expecting much, but I want to know more about Chinese armor than Germany gave a few panzers to China at the end. I can't answer it. I don't even have the books to answer it. I have nothing on those shelves or on those shelves or over there that will give me that answer. Sorry. Van Owen, each of the major conflicts that the US military has been part of in World War I have had a major impact in US tank doctrine. World War II saw the doctrine develop a great deal from tanks being machine gun centric to almost proto main battle tanks. What were the developments in U.S. tank doctrine of note for the Korean War? What were the lessons for the Soviet Chinese armies incorporated into their doctrines? I don't know. And I don't think there were any particular doctrinal issues for the Korean War either. Now, what the Korean War did do was it spurred technological development. There was the Korean tank panic, which, of course, led to the M47, which the U.S. Army didn't want. But by God, we've got to have a tank right now. So they took the T-42 turret, and they took the M46 hull, they mated them together, and, you know, okay, you are hereby blessed, go kill commies. And of course it missed the Korean War. The Americans have thousands of these things that they now have to offload and give them all to their allies. And then they saw service as German tanks in the Battle of the Bulge movie in Spain in the summer in desert. Yeah, that was one of the worst movies. I know. And also, of course, the T-43 was part of the panic as well, which turned into the M-103. Although that was more of an incidental part, because the IS-3 was the real source of the M-103 panic. If there was any one battle or event, unless I am completely misremembering, M-24, I have Estes's book on the M103 somewhere. At least I could have sworn it. Ah, here it is. So this is a more recent book than Honeycutt. Let's see what Ken has to say here. US war planning focused on the first 12, 18 months with the USSR. Military operations against the Soviet Army, so we're talking about the IS-3. Production funds ran out with the end of the war. Funds remain scarce, but the political and strategic surprise of the Korean War and the incipient army tank crisis caused T-41, 42, and 43 to all be rushed into production in one form or another. So, okay, no. M103 was very definitely not a result of the Korean tank panic, but it was brought forward because of the Korean tank panic. It's a bit like Panther and T-34 then, I guess. If there was one battle or event I could take a time machine back to see, what would it be and why? Assume I have free movement around the area at will and I'm immune from harm or interaction. That's a good question. Good Lord, what would I do? Huh. I mean, if I have God mode and I can zap from location to location, or do I have to be sort of stuck in one hill and, you know, go around as far as I can in a Jeep? And it wouldn't be any of the modern stuff, because, you know, anything the US Army's been involved in recently has been daft. Falklands War, since I've always liked it as a item of study, I guess. Get into my invulnerable helicopter and fly around. It's within range. Sit in Admiral Woodward's ready room. I think it's maybe the Golan Heights. 73. That might have been interesting to look at. Robert Henry Ilston, as tanks were upgraded, was it feasible or practical for crews to acquire or keep the outdated equipment for use as emergency spares? And how common would it be for crews to adapt captured equipment, like rifles, SMGs, etc., for use? And how well police was this practice? Well, it happened. It happened in World War II. It even happened in the Iraq invasion. There were stories of people, because when the original invasion happened, the basis of issue for small arms was not what it was when I went a year and a bit later. And there are stories of tank commanders grabbing Kalashnikovs, for example, and giving the M16 to the loader. Which seems daft because the loader's got a pintle-mounted 240, but whatever. Keeping the outdated equipment, generally speaking, if you were turning something in, you're supposed to turn it in intact. And it would not be surprising for there to be a turn-in inspection. Because, again, this is sort of peacetime, modern warfare stuff. Because if any part of the tank is missing, then somebody gets to pay for it. There will be, when you're going to turn in equipment, you do a full inspection. You turn in the equipment, if not serviceable, as near to serviceable as you can practically get. Now, in World War II, if you're turning in your M4A1 and you're getting an M4A3, I can see perhaps there being a little bit less leeway, but or less stringency. But I'm trying to think what you would take out of your M4A1 and put into your M4A3 that you wouldn't already have in the M4A3. So, was it feasible? Yeah, I guess. Did it happen much? Probably not. Grim, since the failure of the Shillelagh missiles... It's okay. Has the US military ever looked at bringing back gun-launched missiles like the Israeli Lahat? Outside of the aforementioned MRM, no, I don't believe so. Since it's almost Halloween, what tanks would fill the five main roles of a tank-themed horror film? The roles being the monster, the jock, the pretty girl, the responsible girl, and the skeptic guy. I don't watch horror movies. Don't like them very much. Okay, the monster. What tank would be the monster? Well, you're tempted to go with something big and scary like a king tiger or a mouse, but I guess in horror movies, the monster tends to have this ability to show up where you least expect it and, you know, be sneaky. And, you know, you look away and you look back, then suddenly it's right there in front of you. So something big and mean like that probably isn't going to work. So you want something small and nimble and... Oh, hell, Chucky was supposed to be scary, so why not use a Goliath? You can imagine that in a horror movie. The jock. Bob Semple. The pretty girl. I'm going to assume that the pretty girl has no actual combat capability whatsoever. Again, I don't watch horror movies. So something that looks nice but is absolutely utterly useless. Comet? It's good enough for the Albonians. Maybe something Italian? And then, you know, I'm thinking like an M14 or an M13. What's a good looking but useless tank? Even Crusader has its point. Covenanter, there you go. A prefixed Covenanter. So it gets frozen into place by the radiator. Responsible girl. I'm not actually sure where that fits in a horror movie. Okay, a responsible girl tank. We've had debates as to whether or not a tank is a he, a she, or an it. So I've taken surveys on this. Predominantly, it's like 70% of people will say that their tank is a she. I go for an it. One of my E6's tank commanders was adamant that his tank was male and masculine. Responsible girl, a tank. So a basic looking girl that was reasonable. Leopard 1, maybe? It's got higher skirts than a Centurion. And the skeptic guy. I presume the skeptic guy is a guy who goes second from last. So he's going to hang around a bit. Be sensible, but also probably utterly useless. Well, not utterly useless, but maybe dies valiantly in the end. I don't know. Chieftain, whatever. It's good enough for dragons. I mean, that was a horror movie, right? Kazuki K. The LOSAT system, MGM-166, was cancelled. There isn't much information on the successor program, the CCAT. That was the compact kinetic energy. What the hell's T? Tank? Compact kinetic energy? Something. However, considering the Navy exploration of electromagnetic propulsion for naval weaponry and the development of hypersonic missiles going on for some time with air forces around the world, would it be feasible for an army to start looking back to a hypervelocity solution for anti-tank guided missions? Guided munitions, even if not reliant on pure kinetic energy like HVM, LOSAT, CCAT. You are not the only person to be asking that question. I saw an article recently that was asking exactly the same question. especially with improvements in active protection systems and so on, it seems reasonable to conclude that a hypervelocity missile may be the solution. But I have not... I have not seen anything on any hypervelocity munitions recently. I guess there just hasn't been much of a need for it. I mean, saber rounds are pretty damn accurate. Now, when you're looking at handhelds, perhaps instead of velocity, you might start seeing countermeasures being installed. So hypervelocity missiles, you know, are now the latest big thing in ship killing. But if you go back a few years, you'd find that anti-ship missiles would have their own jammers or counter-jammers or whatever to be survivable against the active defenses, which is what ships were armed with. So ships used to have the passive defenses like chaff, and they'd have active defenses. They would fire missiles at you. They'd fire SeaWiz, close and weapon systems at you. And by zigzagging with jamming or other countermeasures, you can get past the active defenses. I think that is more likely to be fitted to the missile systems like Javelin than going for an entirely new hypervelocity system. My personal opinion. I don't know what is actually happening in that level, or if anybody has thought about putting countermeasures into a missile, into an anti-tank missile. Zaloga's book on Sheridan notes that the caseless propellant for the Sheridan's 152 ammo had a chance to break and spill inside the tank, creating a risk of catastrophic detonation. What was the nature of this propellant and how did it pass service trials, considering the other major caseless propellant was plagued with issues of thermal detonation? I'm not sure it was caseless as much as it was combustible casing in the same manner as a current 120. And it is possible to break a current 120, and the little granules of propellant, if you do this, the little granules of propellant will fall down into the tank and roll around, and it's really nasty. And we had something very close to that. I mentioned in a previous Q&A, the case separation as we're trying to extract around. So that's where you got to be a little bit careful when you're handling the propellant, the casing. And also, if you shave off the waterproof exterior, you could allow moisture into the case as well, which isn't good for the thing. As long as it's normally handled, it shouldn't be an issue. So I don't know what the problem was with the G11's ammunition or any other caseless ammunition that may have been tried, but I'm going to presume that the reason that Sheridan's ammo passed is it's passed with a reasonable expectation of handling, not a I'm an idiot and I'm deliberately throwing this ammunition around inside this tank to break it. Xuda. Three questions. Okay. 1920, U.S. Tank Corps was disbanded. Development of tanks went in the infantry branch for the interwar era. The cavalry branch during the interwar era for combat cars. But tanks were the property of the infantry. Okay. If the U.S. Tank Corps was not disbanded in 1920 and the development of tanks was left to the Tank Corps, would the U.S. Army have been better prepared to fight the panzers in World War II? No, because the big problem was money, not doctrine. The army wasn't given the money to buy the vehicles to develop its doctrine with. And yes, you can make the argument, let's say the Germans were developing the doctrine before the panzers came around, but I think for the practical applications, even the Germans needed to actually put vehicles into the field and drive them. And the U.S. were not, obviously I will be doing a doctrine video for the U.S. I expect to do one probably November of next year. And the U.S. did investigate other methods of using tanks, such as they had their own mechanized brigade. The gasoline brigade, they called it. So the US did try other ways of doing things in addition to the more traditional, the tank supports the infantry thing that the infantry branch would have been most interested in. So I think really it was money that made the difference, not who was controlling tank development. Should the US Army invest in and develop a 50 to 60 ton IFV like Namur, Armada, and so on? Probably, but I'm not paying for it, so maybe not. What do I think of Track Striker? I don't know, I haven't really looked at it. Entry-level research. From what angles and ranges, something like a 40mm L-70, like on the CV-90-40, with the latest ammunition dangerous to common Cold War and modern tanks? Imagine a hostile CV-90-40 showing up directly behind a T-72 would be bad news for the tank. Yes, it would be. I mean, if you bear in mind that 25mm chain guns were taking out T-55s at least. I would assume that a modern 40mm AP round would do nasty things to a more modern tank. 20 degrees or from the or longer ranges assumed. Hang on a second. 70. So a World War II 76 APCBC has less penetration than a modern 40mm fin stabilized. I suspect that if a CV-90-40 showed up against a T-72, it would shoot AP and it would be effective. If it showed up from the front, it would switch to HE and just pepper the thing to destroy the sensors and then go away, pop smoke and leave. RAW, when an AFV is swimming or fording through a water, do holes for torsion bars cause a significant amount of leakage? Significant, no, but you don't want to stay in there forever. And water is going to get into the system due to pure rain, if nothing else. So there's two things that will, there's two things that you can do to get water out of the tank. One is drain plugs. There are drain plugs in the bottom of the tank. You lift up the drain plug, you empty it out, and then before you go through the next puddle, you make sure you close the drain plug. Also, there is a bilge pump, which on the M1, I think to recall it was on this side. So was it? Hang on, where's the bilge pump? Or is it on this side? It could be that there. There is a small pipe on the upper hull side that is attached to a pump, which pumps water out of the hull of the M1. So as long as you're not leaking too fast, you can stay in relatively deep water for a relatively reasonable amount of time. So between those two things, the leakage isn't bad. There are actually ways of, if you put the torsion bar in a tube, you can prevent even that small amount of leakage from the torsion bars. But again, the tank's not meant to be completely sealed, so that's why you have the drain plugs and the bilge pump. I'm going to insert a picture here and show you where the bilge pump is. Charles Charange, are there plans to do a mix of German, British, or Soviet armor like the US one? Probably not right now, because I don't have the data, the source documentation, to really attack. I mean, I guess I could. Well, you know, I'll have to chew on that one a little bit. I don't think I will do as good a job as I did on the American one, simply because of the access of manuals and the archive documents and research. But now that you put the bug in my ear, I'll have to think about it. But again, I have other videos on the priority list, such as I said, for example, the ordnance procurement one from the last Q&A, which I haven't gotten around to doing yet. Are the definitive numbers for how tanks were knocked out in World War II? Not overall. There would have been samples that you can get, such as, you know, the analysis of tank casualties for Western Europe in World War II. And I've seen, for example, an assessment of how T-34s were knocked out up until until September of 42, I think it was, something like that. But I don't know if there's a consolidated document to look at. I haven't seen it anyway. Okay, most of the way. Sofa mods. Much hubbub surrounds the inefficiencies and diseconomy seen in later German tanks of World War II. See King Tiger, Panther, Jagd, what have you. Whilst even the most economical shovel wasn't going to dig Germany out of its hole, do you think any changes in production or design could have made them more effective in practice or on paper? Give them a damn periscope for the gunner, if you did nothing else. Or at least more economically suitable. And I think had the Germans maintained the original design requirement for Panther's armor instead of succumbing to the extra 2 centimeters that that Adolf wanted, that probably would have done wonders for the Panther. Or do I think said discussions overinflate these inefficiencies and the German war industries are doing the best it could? Now, also, it's possible to say things with the advantage of the hindsight. I mean, the reason I harp on about them for the periscope is that that shouldn't have been a hindsight thing, because they were capturing and dealing with enemy vehicles that had periscopes. The T-34 had a periscope, the BTs had periscope, the Shermans had periscope, the British tanks had periscopes. Why the hell didn't the German tanks have a periscope? The German Stungeschütz had a periscope, for Christ's sake. But generally speaking, I'm sure the German industry was doing the best it could within limits provided by Uncle Adolf. If Canadian dry pin track implies the existence of wet pin track, does raw sewage imply the existence of cooked sewage? It's called processed sewage, I believe. Now, I mentioned Canadian dry pin. Just to be clear, the difference, what made it dry wasn't actually the lack of lubricant. It was a lack of rubber. It was a dead track, not a live track. So there's no rubber bushings or anything inside the pins. Christopher Whitmer, what are the best battles to study to understand how tanks operate and are used? What are the best battles not to use tanks? When I was a CO, one of my favorite assignments to give to new lieutenants was the Egyptian crossing of the Suez Canal in 73. And I would always be sure to tell them to take into account not what actually happened, but also the planning of both sides and why basically the Israelis got completely flat-footed, both for the initial crossing and then why they got massacred when they attempted to counterattack. And not just the planning, but also the psychological conditions, I guess. Because after the 67 war, the Israeli tank corps was the best thing on God's green earth. But 73, they took a few lumps, and the Israeli Air Force took a few lumps dealing with this crossing of the Suez Canal that nobody thought could be done. Even the Soviets said you need to use a nuke or two, a small nuke, to get through. And then along come the Egyptians, and they go, well, we don't care. 20 hours later, they're across in very heavy strength. So, and the other nice thing about it is it's small enough and simple enough that you can really grasp your head around it, especially as a new second lieutenant. So I use it as a lesson in overconfidence, I guess. And I think overconfidence has been the single biggest concern I have about US tankers, because we've always gone up against a second team, usually not with the best equipment, and usually in conditions to our favor. So I don't think a lot of American tankers truly give the enemy the respect that they deserve. Best example of how not to use tanks. Task Force Spam, I think I've mentioned. Somebody, I'm sure, in comments, if I don't mention it now, is going to put up Goodwood. And there is some validity to it. It was not the best example on how to use tanks, but it was also known at the time not to use tanks. So you got to be careful with your criticism. It was more, this was the way it has to be because we have no alternative. But it was still not good for the tanks. What else would I choose? I seem to recall reading about a couple of Japanese tank counterattacks that did not go well. The attitude was, if you've seen the Japanese team in Girls and Panzer, the general attitude is charge. And the anti-tank gunners are going, okay. Not massive tank battles, but still. The Huns got another two would love to have you cover, but feel free to pick one. Oh, questions, okay. Given the trouble DD Shermans have in surviving what seems like anything but calm water, and the fact that some LCTs were already carrying normal Shermans onto the beaches of Normandy, were the DD tanks worth the effort? Wouldn't it have been better to have the LCTs drop the Shermans on the beach all at once? Seems like it would have made it more difficult. That I don't know what happened to the beach defenses in between when the DDs landed and when the LCTs dropped their regular waiting Shermans. In fact, off the top of my head, I can't even remember if it was high tide or low tide that they went in at. I think it was high tide. So if you recall, the beach defenses had the hedgehogs, which had this thing about ripping the bottoms out of landing craft and landing ships, which is probably an issue that the tanks didn't have, because if a DD tank hit one of these things, okay, it's an armored tank, it would just bounce off and go around. So either the water had to go down enough for the LCTs to land, or they had to get time to make lanes for the LCTs to land in the beach without running into these obstacles. So I think that is your answer. Now, this is speculation. It could be a Drachenfels question, I don't know. But I have not actually so far seen anything that directly addresses that. Actually, pretty good question. How did the designers of Sherman get so much right so quickly? Whilst being handicapped with limited budgets and no real-world fighting experience. The evolution of M2 to M3 to M4 happened relatively quickly, yet it was arguably one of the best tanks when fielded and perfectly serviceable. Was it careful planning and great forethought, or stumbling on the right design due to the evolutionary steps of the M2 and M3 prior? The latter. With the M2 and M3, with the M2, they actually had a pretty damn good base. Now, if you remember what the M2 was going up against at the time, you're looking more or less at the era, the tail end of the Christie era tank. So go over to my Christie era video on that one. And if you look at the enhanced capabilities of weight and so on and rigidity battleworthiness, I guess, solidity that the volley suspension gave compared to the Christie suspension, probably just as well that they went to the M2. Now the M2, of course, was a completely stupid design with machine guns bloody everywhere and, you know, a small little cannon up top maybe, but the bones of it were fine with a good engine, good transmission system, good track system, a little narrow perhaps, but even that was deliberate for the requirements. And there were also some other things went on in the background that the army was thinking ahead, shall we say. So the M4 actually had a longer design period than the, you know, 6 to 8 months that you would ordinarily think from looking at the dates. Benedict Wagner, hi Chieftain, how are you? Tired. It's 1 a.m. How long have we been doing this? An hour and a... This is a two-parter. Are tanks like the AMX-13 or Corrosio MBC proved? If yes, how is this achieved? Apparently no. According to Zaloga, if I recall, in Operation Think Tank, it was very difficult to seal that big gap. Crown wagon was tried to be built as a self-contained unit not connected to the driver's position, which could make hermetically sealing the compartments possible. I don't know enough about a crown wagon's turret design to say. Could oscillating return? Not in the same manner. You're looking at external guns like T-14 or RDF or Marder. Andrew Wyatt, what point in the development of the U.S. military does it reach such an advantage over 1945-era Germany that advances in technology and doctrine no longer shorten the time it takes for the U.S. to conquer the country? That's problem. I don't think there is an actual answer to that, because as long as the improvements had the time to be produced and fielded and dropped into the field, then it would have had a difference. So for, you know, an excellent case in point would be the VT fuse. Was it that much of an improvement? Yes. Did it shorten the war? Probably not. Made it easier. Same with HVAP. Was HVAP much of an improvement? Yeah. Did it have an effect? Well, if you had it, yes. Would it have shortened the war had HVAP been available in 1944? I strongly doubt it. TN Sheep, the apocalypse is happening and you get three friends to tag along. What skill class people would you most want to be in a group, i.e. farmer, engineer, carpenter, or cook? It's, I don't have friends. I'd want somebody who knows the way around hunting. Find animals and skin them and so on. Somebody reasonable with mechanics. I mean, if the apocalypse is really happening, I don't think an electrician is going to be required. So a mechanic or engineer. I'm not bad with the mechanical side, but I guess that would be one of them. And option three. I guess I better answer my wife or she's going to be very angry.
All right, so that was longer than I expected. In terms of hours,
I don't know in hindsight if it was easier to do it this way or if I would have been better off doing the advanced research and scripting and being more efficient with the actual recording time. We'll see. Anyway, that is that for that for this Q&A. Hope you found it interesting and informative. I'll see you on the next one.